Silverton Audio presents the unabridged recording of Lysistrata, written by Aristophanes and translated from the Greek. Narrated by Marnie Young. Foreword by Jack Lindsay. Lysistrata is the greatest work by Aristophanes. This blank and rash statement is made that it may be rejected. But first, let it be understood that I do not mean it is a better written work than The Birds or The Frogs, or that to descend to the scale of values that will be naturally imputed to me, it has any more appeal to the collectors of curious literature than the Ecclesia Susae or the Thesmophoria Susae. On the mere grounds of taste, I can see an at least equally good case made out for The Birds. That brightly plumaged fantasy has an aerial wit and color all its own. But there are certain works in which a man finds himself at an angle of vision where there is an especially felicitous union of the aesthetic and emotional elements which constitute the basic qualities of his uniqueness. We recognize these works as being welded into a strange unity, as having a homogeneous texture of ecstasy over them that surpasses any aesthetic surface of harmonic color, though that harmony also is understood by the deeper welling of imagery from the core of creative exaltation. And I think that this occurs in Lysistrata. The intellectual and spiritual tendrils of the poem are more truly interwoven, the operation of their centers more nearly unified, and so the work goes deeper into life. It is his greatest play because of this, because it holds an intimate perfume of femininity and gives the finest sense of the charm of a cluster of girls, the sweet sense of their chatter and the contact of their bodies that is to be found before Shakespeare, because that mocking gaiety we call Aristophanes reaches here its most positive acclamation of life, vitalizing sex with a deep delight, a rare happiness of the spirit. Indeed, it is precisely for these reasons that it is not considered Aristophanes' greatest play. To take a case which is sufficiently near to the point in question, to make clear what I mean, the supremacy of Antony and Cleopatra in the Shakespearean aesthetic is yet jealously disputed, and it seems silly to the academic to put it up against a work like Hamlet, but it is the comparatively more obvious achievement of Hamlet, its surface intellectuality, which made it the favorite of actors and critics. It is much more difficult to realize the complex and delicately passionate edge of the former play's rhythm, its tides of hugely wandering emotion, the restless, proud, gay, and agonized reaction from life, of the blood, of the mind, of the heart, which is its unity, than to follow the relatively straightforward definition of Hamlet's nerves. Not that anything derogatory to Hamlet or The Birds is intended, but the value of such works is not enhanced by forcing them into contrast with other works, which cover deeper and wider nexus of aesthetic and spiritual material. It is the very subtlety of the vitality of such works as Antony and Cleopatra and Lysistrata that makes it so easy to undervalue them, to see only a phallic play and political pamphlet in one, only a chronicle play in a grandiose method in the other. For we have to be in a highly sensitized condition before we can get to that subtle point where life and the image mix, and so really perceive the work at all, whereas we can command the response to a lesser work which does not call so finely on the full breadth and depth of our spiritual resources. I amuse myself at times with the fancy that Homer, Sappho, and Aristophanes are the inviolable trinity of poetry, even to the extent of being reducible to one, for the fiery and lucid directness of Sappho, if her note of personal lyricism is abstracted, is seen to be an element of Homer, as is the profoundly balanced humor of Aristophanes, at once tenderly human and cruelly hard, as of a god to whom all sympathies and tolerances are known, but who is invulnerable somewhere, who sees from a point in space where the pressure of Earth's fear and pain, and so its pity, is lifted. It is here that the Shakespearean and Homeric worlds impinge and merge, not to be separated by any academic classifications. They meet in this sensitivity equally involved and aloof, sympathetic and arrogant, suffering and joyous. And in this relation, we see Aristophanes as the forerunner of Shakespeare, his only one. We see also that the whole present aesthetic of Earth is based in Homer. We live and grow in the world of consciousness bequeathed to us by him, and if we grow beyond it through deeper Shakespearean ardors, it is because those beyond are rooted in the broad basis of the Homeric imagination. To shift that basis is to find the marshes of primitive night and fear alone beneath the feet. Christianity. And here, we return to the question of the immorality of Lysistrata. First, we may inquire, is it possible for a man whose work has so tremendous a significance in the spiritual development of mankind, and I do not think anyone nowadays doubts that a work of art is the sole stabilizing force that exists for life, is it possible for a man who stands so grandly at the head of an immense stream of liberating effort to write an immoral work? Surely the only enduring moral virtue which can be claimed is for that which moves to more power, beauty, and delight in the future. The plea that the question of changing customs arises is not valid, for customs ratified by Aristophanes, by Rabelais, by Shakespeare, have no right to change. If they have changed, let us try immediately to return from our disgraceful refinements to the nobler and more rarefied heights of lyric laughter, tragic intensity, and wit, for we cannot have the first two without the last. And, anyhow, how can a social custom claim precedence over the undying material?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.